no extra dimensions, four dimensions. And the reason we don't see any extra dimensions is that there aren't any. It's all about four dimensions. And you should look very carefully at four dimensions and ask, what is very, very special about four-dimensional geometry? There's a lot of very interesting things that happen only in four dimensions.
Uh-huh.
And can we use those? And especially the geometry of spinners and twisters. I won't really get into twisters, but twisters are a very beautiful idea to understand conformal geometry in four dimensions. And they're very, very tied to four-dimensional geometry. They really are. So it's an idea of Roger Penrose's. And there's part of the whole story of the spinners.
Yes.
But the other thing which I'm trying to use, which hasn't really been used very much, I think one thing to say about all of this, the story that I told you, if you go and look at any of those books about any of those, these guts or supersymmetry or supergravity or string theory, you'll find one strange thing if you start to dig into the technicalities. That our space-time has this so-called Minkowski metric that you put a minus sign on the distance squared in time.
Mm-hmm.
And if you try and write down these theories in any legitimate way, you find that there are technical problems if you try to do it in this indefinite Minkowski signature. So what you do is you assume that you look at this case as if all four dimensions were the same, as if there was no distinguished time. And then you write the theory there, and you do something called Wick rotation to recover what happens in Minkowski spacetime. I think, if you look at all of the literature on all the theories I've been talking about, there's really, in every case, it always is like kind of a technical problem about, wait a minute, don't we need to do this in Euclidean signature? Are we doing it? How is it going to go from one to the other? And it's kind of a technical problem, which was there for all of these theories, but people just kind of tried to avoid thinking about it. There was always a feeling, okay, this is some technicality, maybe some mathematician will figure it out. We don't care. We're just going to write down formulas and hope for the best. But this is something that it really struck me that you really, this relationship between Euclidean and Minkowski signature was a really interesting topic.
It was indicative of something?
Well, it was something that we really didn't understand. I mean, it always, in my mind, I mean, we had the standard theory. There are parts of it that I look at it and say, I understand that perfectly. It's beautiful. It all comes from a simple symmetry argument. There's no technicalities are easy. That's done, cooked. That's it. There are other parts of the subject where you look at something and say, wait a minute, there isn't a clear explanation for exactly what's going on here. And this Wick rotation was a place that was that happens in the standard model. So anyway, the main new idea is to say what I'm trying to do is to claim that this Wick rotation, if you think about your geometry in terms of spinners, it changes the geometry of the spinners in a very fundamental way. That the geometry of spinners in Euclidean signature and the geometry of spinners in Minkowski signature is actually quite different. And the basic idea, this is the idea that I had going way back, which I didn't think could work, but which I'm now convinced does, is that in the four-dimensional rotation group, I'll say more about it, but it breaks up into two SU2 factors. And the idea is that when you Wick rotate to Minkowski space-time, one of those two factors is going to be a space-time symmetry. The other one is going to be an internal symmetry.
Right. Interesting.
And this provides kind of a new unification of internal and space-time symmetry. So these things get unified on the Euclidean side. And it just involves the degrees of freedom that we know about. There's no extra, nothing extra. The new thing is to say, wait a minute, it is to say, look, you really should think about what's going on at the Euclidean signature, and you should realize that there's a very important subtlety when you try to make spinners go back and forth between these Minkowski and Euclidean.
So let me see if I can do a quick summary. There's the Pythagorean theorem. It's a squared plus b squared equals c squared. And that's for two dimensions. And then if you want to do something in three dimensions, it's like a squared plus b squared plus c squared equals the hypotenuse or whatever you're trying to measure. You have to take a square root. But the point is that you have something plus something else plus something else. Now, in Einstein's theory, you have something plus something plus something minus something else. And that minus causes some issues. For instance, with the Feynman path integral, it creates an oscillation. So sometimes you have to you want to do something called wick rotating, which means that you take that minus sign, which is technically an imaginary for technical reasons, into something that's a positive, into something that's a real number. So then you have something plus something plus something plus something. And that's a much nicer space to be in. Additionally, you have this low dimensional coincidence with spin 4 being akin to SU2 cross SU2, more than akin. They're equivalent or isomorphic to it. So I thought you were going to use SU4.
Okay. Actually, let me go on that. So it's more SU4, but I was going to say a bit more. Let me specifically answer some of that, because I'll try to explain. So this was just kind of an overall, and let me see how much I can do of that. Okay, so let me just first, wick rotation. So another way of getting this minus sign on the square is to change from, put in a factor of the square root of minus one.
Mm-hmm.
So what this is, so wick rotation is, but what it's supposed to be doing is you've got a time variable, and it's saying, okay, you can make the time variable complex, and then look at a theory where that your time has become purely imaginary, okay? And then that minus sign there, which is going to, when you multiply this by itself, the two factors of I are going to cancel that minus sign, and you're going to, everything is going to be plus. So the idea is that I refer to this as going from Minkowski, which is real time, to Euclidean, which is imaginary time. So I'll go back and forth between saying Minkowski and Euclidean, or real time and imaginary time. But you can do this even for the simplest quantum mechanical models. You can start thinking about what happens if I make time imaginary, and that's simplistic version of wick rotation. Here's the problem when you try and do this in quantum field theory. So if you how are you going to do this? This starts to get a bit technical, but if you a quantum field theory, you've got these field operators, and they depend on time. Now, if you say I'm going to make them depend on a complex time, so then what happens is that these fields in this Heisenberg picture, if you change time on them, you're conjugating by the Hamiltonian operator.
Right.
That's the Heisenberg picture. So what this is saying is that if you try to go to imaginary time, if you make imaginary time non-zero, you're going to conjugate by this operator, the exponential of the imaginary time times the Hamiltonian. But now, here's your problem. The Hamiltonian, its eigenvalues are the energy, so it's an operator that has a spectrum which is all at positive energy, but which goes off to infinity in the cases we're interested in. So, a typical theory of even of a simple particle, it has to have positive energy, but it can have an arbitrarily high positive energy.
Mm-hmm.
So now your problem is that, you've got these two operators, e to the tau times h and e to the minus tau times h. And if tau is positive, this one is going to make sense, because it's e to the minus something positive times something positive, whereas this one's going to be a problem. This one is just going to become exponentially large. Whereas if tau is negative, then it's going to be the opposite. So there's just a fundamental issue, which everything we know about quantum field theories and the operator formalism, you can't analytically continue the theory. You can't make time complex and have it behave the way you want, because you're going to immediately have the rules for what's going to happen to the field just don't make any sense. You can't do it. So that's what happens in the operator formalism. But the other formalism you have for writing down quantum field theories has the opposite behavior. If you write them down as path integrals, if you go to imaginary time, this Euclidean space time, then the path integrals are e to the minus something large, positive and large, and they make perfect sense.
Mm-hmm.
So you're integrating some kind of Gaussian thing or something that falls off at infinity very nicely. But if you try and do this in Minkowski spacetime or real time, then what you find is that you're trying to integrate over some infinite dimensional space e to the I times something. So you're integrating this wildly varying phase over an infinite dimensional space, and this it actually just doesn't make sense in any sense as a measure or as a real integral, okay? So these two kind of formalisms we like to use to do path, to do quantum field theory, they have opposite. You know, people will talk about them as if you can go use them to go between imaginary and real time, but you can't. I mean, each of the one of them works well in real time and is kind of a formal object in imaginary time. The other one has, is the opposite.
I'm confused. Are you saying that Wick rotation is defined in the Feynman case, but not the operator formalism? Because if those formalisms are physically equivalent and you can translate between them, why would it work in one but not the other?
Well, I mean, I'm saying you can't Wick rotate either one. I'm just saying. These two are two main formalisms for how we know how to write down a quantum field theory. Have, you know, one works in one case and doesn't really work in the other case, and the other was the opposite. So if you tell me I want to understand how to go back and forth, you know, we don't have a theory that does that.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. So we don't, there is no such, this took me a long while to realize that there is no such thing as any kind of full theory and formalism, which depends upon complex time analytically and allows you to analytically continue between time and imaginary time. There just is no such thing.
Now, is that problem in both directions? That is, if you start with the Euclidean and then you try to get Minkowski versus the opposite?
Yeah, because only one of these works, depending where you start, you've only got one that really works. And but if you try to start with either one and get to the other, you can't.
Yes, I get it. Yeah.
It just doesn't work. So, but there is something you can do. So what, you can't analytically continue the theory. So you can't take your operator states, measures, and all these things and analytically continue them. But what you can do, there are things that do analytically continue. So you can define these things called Whiteman functions. They're just vacuum expectation values of operators. So you take a product of two operators at two different spacetime points, you multiply and you apply them, you hit the vacuum with them, you get another state, and then you take the inner product of that state with the vacuum again. And anyway, and you get things depend upon X and Y. And they're, these kind of carry most of the information about the theory in them. And so if you have an operator theory, you can compute these objects and you can characterize the theory, a lot of the theory, by these objects. And they're kind of, I mean, the operators don't commute, so this thing is not symmetric in X and Y. If you interchange X and Y, you're going to get something different. They're also, technically, these are distributions, they're not functions. These are things more like delta functions. They don't make sense as actual functions, but you can kind of take convolution of them with functions and get something that makes sense. That's what you can do in real time and an operating formalism. And then in the imaginary time, and the path integral formalism, you can take similar things, which are moments of these, anyway, similar path integrals are kind of moments of these measures. And they correspond in a one-to-one way with the Whiteman things, except that they're symmetric. But it's a very different kind of theory. It's the calculation you're doing and the whole theoretical setup. I mean, there's no states, there's no operators, there's just these measures and these integrals. And they look a lot more like what you do in statistical mechanics. And actually, they're really kind of, one of the amazing things about this whole story is that if you take your imaginary time to have a finite extent of size beta, and you do this calculation, it's precisely a statistical mechanical calculation at a temperature, you know, given by beta is equal to 1 over k times the time. So it's a very different. The path integral formalism really is much more like a statistical mechanical system. It's very different than the operator formalism. But the output of it are some functions, the Schringer functions, which can be analytically continued to the Whiteman functions.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 Toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's Obsession.